Hi guys, I welcome you all to today's discussion on finance related current affairs pertaining to RBI, and the topic which we are going to cover today is FinTech Sandbox Model. So this topic was in news recently, and RBI has also recently come up with a draft proposal or a draft report on this FinTech Sandbox Model. So we are going to learn about the basic aspects of this particular model, how RBI is going to tackle this particular model, how finance ministry is going to work upon this particular fintech space, and at the end of this particular video we are also going to discuss some of the important MCQs based on it. Now before proceeding forward, let me quickly tell you about the excellent results that we have achieved over the past few years. Now in 2017, in RBI grade B we had 27 final selections from our students, and in NABARD grade A we had 11 final selections from our students. And in 2018 we repeated the same success story, and in RBI grade B we had 70 plus final selections, and in NABARD grade A we had 26 final selections. Also in 2018 SEBI grade A examination, out of the total 84 selections, 41 of our students they made it to the final list, and in the IBPS AFO examination our students have got 100 plus interview calls. Now if I talk about the different individual courses that we are providing, then they include RBI grade B, SEBI grade A, NABARD grade A, RBI assistant, and IBPS AFO examinations. Now apart from running the separate courses for all those individual examinations, we are also having some combo courses which you can avail. So we have a combo for RBI grade B, NABARD grade A, and SEBI grade A. We are also having a combo for RBI grade B, NABARD grade A, SEBI grade A, RBI grade B, and NABARD grade A, and SEBI grade A. So we have all the requisite combos that you can choose from, and you can choose the appropriate course as per your requirements. Let me also tell you about our new course, which is very important for all the banking exams. This is the QRE course. QRE, that is Quantitative Aptitude, Reasoning Ability, and English. So all these aspects which are very important for all the banking exams, they are going to be covered in this particular course. So before proceeding, let me quickly just tell you about the different headlines which were there in the news. So first one was RBI to set up regulatory sandbox for fintech firms. Startups see RBI's fintech sandbox as a positive but wary of some clauses. FinMin to set up to issue policy norms for fintech sector. RBI proposes to allow fintech startups to test regulatory sandbox. So these were the headlines which were there in the news, and they are laying the basic background for our further discussion. So we are going to talk about regulatory sandbox. We are going to talk about how RBI's new draft is aiming at providing a regulatory sandbox for fintech firms. We are also going to talk about how finance ministry is planning to tackle the different policy issues pertaining to the fintech sector, and particularly I am going to tell you about the take of Honorable Finance Minister on this financial technology sector. So let's start with the basics. Let me quickly tell you about the fintech firms. Now fintech, this is basically a combination of two words, that is technology and financial services, and it is also referred to as financial technology. Now technology, it has been a part of the financial services industry, but recently it is becoming more of a bigger part, and it is emerging to cover all of the recent developments which are taking in the financial services industry. All of these are directly or indirectly related to the technology front. Hence fintech is now the buzzword, and this is used to describe the new technology that not only seeks to improve but also automate the delivery and use of the financial services. So the financial services are now being delivered automatically. You need not contact the clerk in the bank. You just need to log on to your bank ID, and you can simply print out all the reports or check out your balance, and everything you want you can do at just a click away. So this technology is transforming the financial services sector, and it is in this regard that RBI is now taking a bigger role, and RBI is planning to provide a regulatory sandbox which can basically provide a ground on which this fintech sector can further develop. Now let me also quickly tell you about the different examples of fintech startups which are there operating in India. Now we need not learn these examples, but these are just given here to just reinforce this concept of fintech firms or fintech startups so that you can know what are the different emerging areas with regard to financial technology. For example, there is a company called LendingCart. It is providing loans for working capital needs of small and medium enterprises, and these loans are given very quickly and without any collateral with minimal amount of paperwork. There is another fintech platform, Credex. Now, this is India's first invoice discounting marketplace. So, small and medium enterprises, they have different invoices with them, and they can get those invoices discounted through this particular platform and raise money. Another one is RubyQ. Now this is an online technology led marketplace which is offering a wide range of loan products which would help in fulfilling or providing different sorts of services to not only individuals but also MSMEs. There is another startup by the name ZipLoan, which is providing unsecured small business loans to SMEs in India with flexible terms and no hidden prepayment charges. Further, IndiaLends, this is another fintech platform, and it aims to reorganize the entire unorganized lending sector in India through its underwriting technologies and techniques. So you can see that how the financial technology startups, they are working towards transforming the entire SME space in the country. So particularly for the SME space, these fintech startups, they are going to be a game changer, and they are going to usher in easy money for these firms so that they can expand, they can build upon, or they can just continue their existing businesses. Now let's talk about the regulatory sandbox and how RBI is planning to launch this regulatory sandbox for fintech firms. Now let's take a look about what is a regulatory sandbox. Now sandbox is basically a hub where regulators, they can launch their products or services on a limited scale. So sandbox is basically a small space, small platform in which the companies or the producers of products or services, they can launch their products or services at a small scale before actually scaling up. So this box or this hub can enable the fintech companies or financial technology companies to launch innovative products at a lower cost and in less amount of time before actually going to market for serving the entire market. So they can actually test their products, the regulators can also test their products, and even the customers, they can also test those products before they actually enter the commercial production phase. Now industry experts and fintech startups, they feel that the sandboxes, they are going to help the startups test their new products with less amount of capital than usually required. So this is going to save them lots of money, as they can test earlier in advance whether their products or services, they are suited for the market, or they would actually work, or they would actually succeed. So this regulatory sandbox, it allows the regulator, that is the RBI, the innovators, the financial service providers which are coming up with new products and services, and the consumers or the final users to be part of this entire sandbox experience and to test the new products or services and carefully monitor and take appropriate actions to tackle all the risks or the issues which may come up in the commercial production phase. So this is beneficial for all the stakeholders in this particular fintech industry. Now what are going to be the benefits and risks of this regulatory sandbox for fintech firms? Now let's take a look at the benefits of the regulatory sandbox. Now the first benefit is that regulatory sandbox fosters learning by doing approach. So the different industries or the different regulators, they can obtain first-hand evidence about the benefits and risks of the emerging technologies through this regulatory sandbox approach. So financial service providers, including banks, they can also improve their understanding about whether these new financial technologies that they are testing, they will actually work or they will not. Further, the users of the regulatory sandbox, they can test the viability of their product at a very less scale and without an expensive rollout. And if they believe that the product has the potential that it can succeed in the future, then they can launch that full-fledged product. Further, these fintech also provide solutions for furthering financial inclusion in the country. So we have seen that different sorts of new products and services they are going to enter the industry, and ultimately they are going to help in promoting financial inclusion by including all the individuals, the unorganized sector, the SME space into the financial inclusion ambit. So they are going to provide a thrust to the sectors like microfinance, small savings, microinsurance products, remittances, mobile banking, and digital payments for the retail users. Further, the regulatory sandbox could also lead to better outcomes for the consumers as well. Consumers would have an increased range of products and services, and they can get access to those at a reduced cost, and they can test and give their feedback about the new emerging technologies. Now let's talk about the risks and limitations attached to this regulatory sandbox model. Now, the innovators, they may lose flexibility and time in going through this RS, that is regulatory sandbox process. So innovators may want that we just want to launch our product now and here only. We do not want to go through this regulatory sandbox process first. We just want to get to the market right away. So they lose their flexibility and time when they go through this regulatory sandbox process, and they feel that this is a limitation for them. Further, RBI or the regulatory sandbox, they cannot provide any legal waivers. So in the garb of regulatory sandbox, you cannot do anything illegal. Further, post sandbox testing. So after you have tested your products or services, if you are successful, you would still require regulatory approvals before you can make your products available on a wider scale. So it does not do away with the regulatory approvals. Further, regulators can potentially face some legal issues. For example, if the customer is part of a new product which is being launched in the regulatory sandbox approach, and if there are losses to the customer, then who is going to resolve that particular issue? So different legal issues, they may also arise. Further, in the regulatory sandbox, we have to get some relaxations from the regulator as well. And for this, we would have to approach the regulator, and regulator will take the time, and on its discretion, it will give us the appropriate relaxations. So this will lead to loss of time, and we may not be successful in this particular time period to launch our products successfully or to test our product successfully without any hassles. Now, sandboxing is not just limited to the fintech space or to the RBI or even to the India. It is a global phenomena. How it is a global phenomena? Now, first and foremost, even in India, IRDA, that is Insurance Regulatory and Development Authority of India, is also planning to use sandbox approach to test digital and tech-based innovations in the insurance industry. Further, the sandboxing is also happening globally, and in the last couple of years, regulators in different Asian countries including Singapore, Hong Kong, Thailand, Indonesia, apart from US and EU, they have their own fintech sandbox. So this is not something which is coming to India for the first time or coming to the world for the first time. So this is a global phenomena. Now let's just quickly take a look at the background of this particular news item. Now, recently, RBI Governor Mr. Shaktikant Das said that the central bank is going to set up a regulatory sandbox for which the guidelines they are going to be issued very soon. So this was announced by RBI Governor. And why this was to be done? The aim was to have appropriate regulatory and supervisory framework in order to ensure an orderly development of the fintech space. So let's face it, the fintech space is developing on its own. Now, if we provide a regulatory sandbox, it would come under some sort of regulatory and supervisory framework, which would benefit not only the customers, but the entire stakeholders involved in this particular process. Further, RBI's working group on fintech and digital banking also suggested the introduction of a regulatory sandbox or innovation hub within a well-defined space and duration to experiment with the fintech solution. So this was also suggested by one of the RBI's working group. And it was in line with these recommendations that RBI recently released the draft enabling framework for regulatory sandbox, highlighting the benefits of regulatory sandbox and acknowledging that regulatory sandbox fosters learning by doing. Now let's take a look at the key points in this particular draft, which has been released by RBI. The proposed financial services to be launched under the regulatory sandbox approach should include, number one, new or emerging technology. So either it should be a new or emerging technology, or it should make use of existing technology, but in an innovative way, and it should address a problem or it should bring some benefits to the consumers. Further, the target applicants which can enter this regulatory sandbox are going to be the financial technology firms and DAC 2, which meet the eligibility conditions which have been prescribed for the startups by the government. So only those financial technology firms which are complying with the eligibility conditions which are prescribed for the startups by the government, they are going to be eligible for participating in this regulatory sandbox. Further, the innovative products and services which could be considered, they would include retail payments, money transfer services, marketplace lending, digital KYC, and financial advisory services. And not only these, it would include wealth management services, digital identification services, smart contracts, financial inclusion products, cyber security products, etc. And further, innovative technologies that could be brought under the sandbox could include mobile technology applications like payments through mobile technology, verifying digital identity through mobile technology, data analytics, application program interface or APIs, blockchain technologies, and artificial intelligence, including machine learning applications. So we can see that the scope of the products which can be tested in this particular regulatory sandbox framework is very wide. So you can test all sorts of products pertaining to the financial technology industry. But now there is a but. You cannot test all the products and services. There is a restriction, there is a negative list which is also in place. What's that negative list? We are also going to learn about in the coming slide. So what can't be tested on this regulatory sandbox framework? So the entities can't test their products on this regulatory sandbox. They won't be suitable for this regulatory sandbox if the proposed financial service is similar to those that are already being offered in India. So if you are coming up with a idea which is very much similar to the debit cards which are already in place in India, we are not going to allow you to test your particular product or service because it's very much similar to the existing one. Further, there is an indicative negative list of products and services and technology which would not be accepted for testing. Now this includes credit registry, credit information, cryptocurrency, so bitcoins a big no, trading in cryptocurrency, initial coin offerings, so IPOs pertaining to cryptocurrency a big no, chain marketing services, and any product or service which has been banned by the regulator or the government of India. So quite simply, the credit related services, registry or information, and the cryptocurrency related services, they are going to be out of the ambit of the regulatory sandbox. Now let's also take a look at the reaction which was given to this particular draft by the startup industry. Now overall, the startups, they have welcomed the RBI's proposal that it is going to allow them to test new financial products in real time with limited regulations under the regulatory sandbox. However, they are wary of the eligibility criteria. As we have already seen, there are restrictions pertaining to eligibility that only those entities which are qualifying the startup related norms, they are going to be eligible for regulatory sandbox. So this fintech sandboxing will only be for a limited set of customers, and only 10 to 12 fintech companies are actually going to participate due to the strict eligibility criteria. Further, the RBI draft also makes it mandatory for the companies to share the results of proof of concept testing of use cases before entering the sandbox. So you would have to show some proof that your concept would actually work and you would have actually tested it before you can enter the sandbox space. Further, RBI has also made it mandatory for companies to have an acceptable exit and transition strategy in case the product or service is not successful and it is to be discontinued. So there should also be an exit strategy in place. However, the founders of the fintech startup, they point out that businesses ideally do not have a conclusive exit plan in place. So having this kind of a strategy or plan, this could hamper the entry of the startups into the regulatory sandbox. So overall, they are happy, but they have some issues with regard to the eligibility criteria. Now let's also take a look at a related issue, which is the finance ministry's take on the financial technology industry or the fintech space in India. Now financial finance ministry is soon coming out with a report on fintech or financial technology, and this report is going to specify the broad policy and the regulatory guidelines which would boost the fintech sector in the country. Already an 8-member steering committee was constituted in March last year, that is 2018, which was headed by Finance Secretary Mr. Subhash Chandra Garg, and this report was finalized also recently and is expected to be released soon after the general elections are concluded. So this report, it will not only find ways to make it easier for fintech companies to do business, but it is also going to look how this fintech space can be used to enhance financial inclusion, particularly for the MSME enterprises, that is micro, small and medium enterprises. Further, in the recent budget 2018-19 speech, Finance Minister Mr. Arun Jaitley also emphasized the use of fintech space and how it can benefit the growth of MSMEs in the country. So fintech can be a game changer, can be a booster for the MSME front or the MSME sector in the country. Now, if we talk about the regulation of this fintech space, then the Finance Ministry's Department of Economic Affairs is definitely going to lead the policy related developments for this sector. But it is going to be difficult to pinpoint a single or a specific regulator that would take a look at the various issues pertaining to the fintech sector. This is because this fintech business is spread across various regulators. No one regulator can tackle all the different issues relating to the fintech space. Though RBI is going to be there to look into any payment related issue, but in case of any other problem, the company may have to approach the concerned ministry or the concerned regulator in that particular space. And then there will be some areas in which the state and central government would have to collaborate and provide support and intervention for the fintech companies for effective growth and development. So guys, this was all about our discussion. Now let's take a look at some of the important MCQs which can be framed out of this particular topic. First question. Which is a true about regulatory sandbox? It is a hub where regulators enable limited rollout of new products on small group of users before scaling up. It can help fintech companies launch innovative products at a lower cost and in less time. Options are A only is correct, B only is correct, both are correct, or none is correct. So here our answer is going to be option number 3, that is both are correct as per the discussion we have just had. Next question, which of the following is not a benefit of regulatory sandbox? Regulatory sandbox fosters learning by doing. Users of a regulatory sandbox can test the product's viability without the need for a larger and more expensive rollout. It can provide legal waivers. All are its benefits. So as we've already seen that a regulatory sandbox cannot provide legal waivers. So option number 3 is not going to be the benefit. So this is going to be our answer for this particular question. Next question, RBI has recently released draft enabling framework for regulatory sandbox. Which is true about the same? The proposed financial service to be launched under the regulatory sandbox should include new or emerging technology, or it should use existing technology in an innovative way. The target applicants for entry to this particular space are financial technology or fintech firms which meet the eligibility conditions prescribed for startups by the government. Both are correct or none is correct. So this particular draft enabling framework for regulatory sandbox, we have already learned about the key features of the same, and we have seen that both of these statements in this regard, they are true. So our answer is going to be option number 3. Next question. As per RBI's recently released draft enabling framework for regulatory sandbox products and services, which could be considered for testing under the regulatory sandbox, include all of the following except. Options are retail payments, cryptocurrency, money transfer services, or digital KYC. So we have seen that cryptocurrency cannot be tested under the regulatory sandbox approach. So our answer is going to be option number 2. Next question. Which of the following is true about the fintech space in India? Fintech, the word is a combination of financial technology. Now this is very true. In his budget 2018-19 speech, Finance Minister said that the use of fintech will help the growth of MSMEs. This is also true. fintech business is spread across various sectors and outside the ambit of one particular regulator. Now, this again is also true. Next is all of the above. So here all of the above statements are going to be true and our answer is going to be option number 4. So guys, these are the answers to the questions. So guys, this was all about our discussion. If you are having any query, you can mail us at hello@edutap.co.in or you can reach us at 8146207241. You can call us or you can WhatsApp us. And I would also recommend that you visit our website www.edutap.co.in for regular updates and important content on the respective examinations. Thank you guys. I wish you happy learning and all the best from the entire team.